December quarter earnings continue, M&A back in vogue as some companies look to ride the tailwinds of our thematic investing lens, and we share our views on what's going to be driving the markets from here. All that and so much more coming up on this episode of Cocktail Investing. All right. It is a short week. Thank you, President's Day weekend and the President's Day holiday. But that just means 5 days of activity are compressed into four at a time when we've got hundreds of companies reporting and more economic data than you can shake a stick at. What that means to us here, it's all fodder for us to distill at the Cocktail Investing Podcast. I'm Chris Versace, Tematica's Chief Investment Officer. Had to say that in my head a few times because I've been messing it up lately. And of course,
You just want to be me.
Well, who doesn't, Lenore? Who doesn't want to be you? Come on. And joining me as always, Lenore, the one, the only, Lenore Hawkins, Tematica's Chief Macro Strategist. And it's true, Lenore, who doesn't want to be you? You know, whenever we have to talk about folks and we explain that, you know, the bulk of the team is located outside of Washington, D.C., the other sin city, as I call it. And then we mention that you happen to split your time the way you do. Most people tend to forget about us. So it's just the way it works. So anyway, as per the usual, we've got a lot to cover. But before we do that, let's get to the usual housekeeping. So please go check out tematicaresearch.com. You can see all our wares from the Monday morning kickoff to Lenore's. It seems this thing is winning accolades and more traffic and everything else. The weekly wrap, which is excellent, an excellent way to wind up your Friday or have a nice, easy cup of coffee on Saturday morning the way I do when I read it. So I firmly encourage you guys to take a look at Lenore's weekly wrap. There's also the podcast, our premium products. So again, all of that and more at tematicaresearch.com. So with that out of the way, Lenore, as I look at the calendar, President's Weekend is behind us. Valentine's Day is behind us. It means we're about halfway through the current quarter. And it's fascinating to look at the major U.S. indices because they're nowhere where they were, you know, at the end of January. You got the S&P's up 2%. The Dow, as we stare at the screen, is up just under 1.5%. NASDAQ's up over 5%. And the Russell, not really getting the love, practically unchanged year to date. But I'm the equity geek, Lenore, so I always, you know, focus in on that. You, on the other hand, are the bond guru of the team. So what is going on in bond land?
Well, we're still seeing similar things that started this whole correction with bond yields still working their way up. And actually today, bond yields, the 10-year treasury pushed up above 2.9% today, reaching this morning, I saw the high, it hit a 2.9%. That's Tuesday morning, 2.93%. That's back to where it was in like very, very late 2013, early 2014 highs.
Now,
so those bond yields are still pushing up and the high yields are also pushing up. So we're just seeing rates going up all around, which we will talk about that later, why that is so important and what I think most people are not paying attention to on that.
And when we do that, you're going to talk about, if I remember correctly, because again, I'm not really the bond guy, there's this line at 3% that everybody's kind of keyed in on, right?
Yeah, it's you know, just like you have with, you know, Dow breaks 2,500, you know, 25,000. Like there's just these mental breaks. Well, it's just 3% is one of those.
I understand.
But 3% is just one of those. It's the same kind of thing. It's just a break that people kind of feel like all hell's going to break loose if the 10-year crosses above 3%.
But is it more likely to be Y2K when I woke up the next morning and everything was fine? The world was still going forward.
I don't know. I think this is definitely a different thing than that. The challenge is you've got wages. You know, we talked about this last week, mm-hmm. that wages have been relatively stagnant since the beginning of the recovery.
Despite the big headlines that people are talking about.
Despite the big headlines, wages for the majority of people really haven't gone up much. Yet we've had increase in spending. Well, spending's been increasing because people have been borrowing. Right. And we've got household debt levels are back up to new record highs. Now, what's made that doable? So that's how they've been spending, right? Because you can only spend more if you make more or you borrow more. So they've been making more, so they've been borrowing more. Well, the only reason they've been able to do that is because we had these really, really low interest rates. Now, as interest rates go up, that record high debt becomes less and less affordable.
Yeah, I wondered, I'm going to do my best to segue here. So I wonder, as that happens, is that going to put already beleaguered retailers in an even more difficult spot? And I think that will. And the transition is that, you know, we've actually seen a couple interesting retailers report today. We had Walmart and Home Depot. Walmart, you know, it's fascinating to me. The stock is getting hit some 9-10% at one point. And to me, this is a company that is really in transition. They are doing everything that they can to catch Amazon with the shift towards digital commerce. That's part of our connected society investing theme. And the outlook for the next 12 months is their margins are going to be hit. Why? Incremental investments are going to hit their OpEx more than expected. They're accelerating their investment to make the turn. So I think that's positive. And when you look at Walmart too, and you see some of the things they're doing, online grocery pickup, they're testing same day, next day delivery. They're partnering with Lord & Taylor to create a special experience online. They've even repositioned some of their Sam's Club, so their hubs for their digital offerings. All of that, I just think it shows that they are onto it and investing the right way. Unlike some other companies, like maybe a Target, that's like, oh, should we bring grocery back or should we do this or do that? So to me, as I step back, I continue to think that Walmart is going to be probably number two next to our favorite. And I say that as it's the thematic poster child, that is Amazon, with a third probably being Costco. That's kind of my thought on that whole retail thing. But I will say this, for investors, the pullback, let it get digested, and it could be an opportunity to revisit Walmart shares. Did you see anything on Home Depot? I know you are the queen of repair and remodel.
Yeah, which is usually closely followed by a sort of a bandaging experience.
Well, a bandaging experience and then look, oh my God, did I really spend that much?
Yeah, exactly. Home Depot did really well. And I think this is, we've seen a really tight housing market. Mm-hmm. We see where people tend to be staying in their homes more.
I think it's in part because they can't afford to buy a new home.
Yeah, the supply.
As you have talked about it, as we've seen inventory come down, we've seen the prices just climb. And it's not 1 month, 3 months. It's got to be the last 12, 18, if not 24 months.
They're really reaching some very unaffordable levels for most people. And let's keep in mind, as we see these interest rates go up, that is not making it any more affordable. So in response to that, you're seeing, well, companies like Home Depot are really going to benefit because rather than moving, just spiff up the place. They actually had their comparable store sales for the fourth quarter of fiscal 2017 grew like about 7.5%, and comp sales for U.S. stores were up about 7.2%.
That's, you know, it's funny when you look at, or we look at the monthly retail sales reports and you look at the disparity between certain categories, like the Home Depot one that's killing it, non-store, which is, you know, the government's magic language for digital commerce, you know, killing it, you know, sporting goods stores just getting hurt and other categories. It's fascinating about the polarization of sorts between who's winning and who's losing. Mm-hmm.
Where we're spending our money, how we're spending it. But Home Depot's, I mean, Amazon, granted, they're really trying to step into a bit of Home Depot's turf, like with appliances.
Mm-hmm. Or tools.
Online tools. And even things like toilets you can buy, right? Normally, like a toilet, you wouldn't think of something you can buy from Amazon, but I have actually done that.
Yeah. See, I don't know. I mean, I like that really slow close on the seat. There's no metric for that anywhere on the online, as far as I can tell.
But with Home Depot, you know, a lot of it is you need it today.
Yes, yes.
Right?
Yes,
it's a different thing. It's not, well, I'll get around.
Well, right. So like, I, you know, if you're painting.
Oh, damn. Well, I mean, just broke that.
Yeah, think about it. If you're painting, oh, crap, I'm short a gallon.
Yeah.
Off you go. You can't do that, at least yet, and get the exact same color at the right time, the right way, blah, blah, blah. Through Prime Now, maybe one day.
And weekend projecting is just, it's a whole experience. Like the weekend projecting, you head down to Home Depot, you look at the stuff, you figure out what you want to do.
When you do that, do you slap on the overalls? Do you have the hammer there in the loop on the side?
I do have a tool belt.
You didn't answer the question about overalls though.
I do have overalls as well.
Overalls or coveralls?
Yeah, I have the overalls. Those old fashioned overalls. Yep.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. With the metal things in the front, yep. Whatever, like, with the clasps.
Yep.
Oh boy. All right. All right. So the only other big news that we'll call out today as we're taping is Rite Aid looks like it's quote unquote being acquired by Albertsons. And this is kind of an interesting play because Rite Aid, you know, is grocery.
You've been watching this for a while.
Well, I did. And I'm a little frustrated by this. And I say that because about middle of January, you're right. I did do some digging on it for the Tematica investing select list. And I put it on the side. I put it on the contender list. I wasn't ready to pull the trigger. There were some things I wasn't sure about, namely the influence of Amazon and what might be happening there. Lo and behold, that's exactly what led Albertsons to step in and quasi acquire them. But we've also seen other movements between CVS Health and others. So to me, this is going to be kind of interesting. You know, the Wall Street Journal broke the story this morning. To me, it's going to position Albertsons that much more inside two of our thematic tailwinds, one being cash-strapped consumer as people continue to eat more at home, but also with Rite Aid, our aging of the population investing theme. But here's the one tricky thing that I think, and I'm not really sure about this, there's conflicting reports, but it sounds like Albertsons might reverse merge into Rite Aid and still be a publicly traded company. That would be pretty interesting to watch.
Hmm.
Yeah, that's what I said. But we'll see. But that's just today. And as I said, we're about halfway through the quarter. So let me ask you, Lenore, we've seen the market, you know, volatility is back. We've seen all sorts of data. What if you had to, you know, put your finger on it, on the pulse, what do you think is going to be driving the market over the next 3, 4, 6 weeks, whatever?
Well, I think Morgan Stanley strategist Andrew Sheets said it best. What we just saw, it was the appetizer, not the main course. I think what we've seen with this return of volatility, that is going to continue for quite some time. I think the big driver of this is both volatility and interest rates. I think those two are going to be the big story. And
bringing the other back?
I think it's more, we have been in such a suppressed vol environment for so long, you know, and everybody's talked about some of the volatility, the inverse volatility ETFs have been shut down, right? I mean, they did do exactly what they were supposed to do,
right?
When vol went up 100, you know, nearly went up 100%, they went down like 100%. Well, you know, good job. That's what you were supposed to do. They did it right. But there was, you know, some people were in those that probably should not have been in those. And you and I had talked about how, you know, there's a problem when you're getting tips from like the waiter or the waitress.
Uber drivers.
He's telling you they're making
a change. You know, it's funny you say that. I got picked up to do a hit a couple of weeks back on Fox Business. And usually when I get in the car, I don't tell people like what I do for a living. I just kind of sit back there and do my own thing. And they asked what program I was going to be on. I was on with our mutual friend, Charles Payne, Making Money on Fox Business. And I was taking a call with one of our partners about a particular stock that we were eyeing. So the driver turns around, you know, kind of like he's looking at me while he's driving and he's going, you pick stocks? And I had to kind of like quickly backpedal out of it. But to your point, he was asking for stock tips.
Yeah. Yep. Well, that is what we see when we're right in that toppy bit, right? I mean, all the indications are that. So I think when we take a step back and look at what happened with the market this year, and we have been talking all through 2017 about how volatility had been so depressed.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing is, low vol begets more low vol. And heightened vol begets heightened vol. Right. Because as you think about all the different products are out there, like you have, say, insurance companies will have they want like S&P returns, but they want like set kind of volatility in it.
They usually want lower volatility.
Yeah. They want lower vol. So as volatility goes up, that means they have to reduce the exposure.
Mm-hmm.
And as everyone's doing that, it increases vol, which means you got to reduce exposure, right? So there's all kinds of kind of investment strategies out there that when we see this really low vol, that was part of the story behind the low vol, is lots of investment strategies that low vol begets low vol. Well, now we're getting this heightened vol, and that's going to keep, you know, getting heightened vol. But when we look back over what we've seen so far in 2018, we had the best start of the year since 1987. Then we had a 10% slide in just 9 trading days. Now that was noteworthy, right? Then we just bounced right off the 200-day moving average and followed it up with last week having the biggest one-week advance since 2013, closing the week up 4.3%. We went from very heavily overbought to seriously oversold, then back into overbought. But not everyone's buying it because on the move up, volume was about 22% lower than when we were sliding down.
Now that's fascinating to me, right? Because it sounds as if people are like getting a little more defensive, most likely doing something we've been talking about. They've been cash constrained, raising some cash, potentially waiting for that next pronounced fall off.
Well, the Bank of America Merrill Lynch fund manager survey, their latest one, saw that the overweight in equities dropped from 55% down to 43%, the percent of managers reporting that they were overweight in equities. Now, that's the sharpest decline we've seen in about 2 years.
Inside that report, did they say anything about rising cash levels? Because I know that that's the report that we've been watching that has said there is low to no cash on the sidelines.
That is where most of this is going right now. Okay. They're sure as hell not going into bonds.
No.
Right. And we saw actually global equity ETFs and mutual funds saw about 30 billion net outflows over the past 2 weeks. So yeah, people are nervous. But I will say I've been reading way too much about the big one's coming, the big one's coming. And you just know the one thing you know for sure is that when everybody starts to agree on something else is gonna happen. And there's entirely too many people are going, it's gonna be big.
Sorry, I apologize. When you were talking about the big one, I had like a mental image of Red Fox on that show. it's the big one, Louise. The big one. Sorry.
One of the things, though, that I think is that the market's not really looking at. So we got this story of big tax cuts. And the big tax cuts was going to mean that American companies were going to bring back money from overseas and that was going to be great for the economy. And there was all this talk about, you know, wages were going to go up and that would be fantastic. Companies would be reinvesting back in the economy, right? They would be expanding capacity and all that. And that would be great for the economy. Well, it looks like that's not exactly what's happening. So American companies so far have announced about $171 billion in stock buybacks. Now, that is a record high for this point in the year. And it's more than double the $76 billion that corporations disclosed at the same point back in 2017. Mm-hmm. Now, why that is important is because it counters a major theory that's underpinning the theory of why the economy is going to accelerate this year. A survey of Morgan Stanley analysts that was released just last week found that about 13% of companies' tax cut savings are going to go to pay raises, bonuses, and employee benefits. Only 13%. 43% are going to use that money for stock buybacks and dividends. Now, what's really interesting about that is who owns stocks. The top 10% of households owned about 84% of all stocks in 2016. With the richest 1% owning about 40% of all stocks. So here we go with that widening of the income gap and the wealth gap, where the rich get richer and the poor still struggle.
Right. But, I see the disparity between that 13% and 43%. And I think we talked about this a couple of weeks ago that we would not be surprised if something like this turned out to be the case. Yep. Because, you know, what's one of the big complaints we've heard about employers is they can't find skilled people, you know, that which is a key part of our tooling and retooling investment theme. So it's not surprising that I can't, you know, who I want to build a plant, I want to do more, but I got to train people. What can I do?
Can't find good people.
Right. Luckily, Team Tematica, we're pretty solid. But having said that, though, it's not surprising that that's happening. I think it's just confirmation of some of the things we've been talking about. At the same time, though, I hear you talking about this huge, huge dollar amount committed to buybacks. And I wonder, is this kind of like a safety net that we haven't seen deployed on the market yet? Because, you know, companies are still reporting.
It's a safety net, but it's a one and done. I mean, once they buy back that stock, they can't buy it back again.
Right. But right? I don't
think, it is a bit of a safety net. I mean, in the near, like over until the point where they run out of money to do
exactly.
to do the buybacks.
And that's kind of my point in that I'd be surprised if $171 billion is deployed in a short period of time. Usually it gets dribbed out over 3-4 quarters, sometimes up to 2 years. So there could be nibbling that helps support some stocks more than others, depending on who has a richer program. And, you know, just on the dividend hike front and the buyback hike front, we saw that from MGM, we saw that from Home Depot, and even Walmart today.
And all that's true, unless we see yields going up a lot, because we have record levels of corporate debt.
Mm-hmm.
And that debt has to roll over.
Oh, yeah. And so it's going to be a refinancing. Ouchie!
Exactly. So let's see just how much over time. If yields keep going up like this over time, when that debt rolls over, it's going to be more expensive for them. So maybe they'll pay down some of it.
We'll see. And that, you know, that is a fair point, because while we are seeing companies upsize existing stock buyback programs, you know, if you were to go back 4, 5, 10 years ago, oftentimes companies never actually finished the initial program.
Exactly. Yep.
It's a good point.
So, you know, you put that all together and that's like, well, one of the theories that's underlying, oh, the economy is really going to accelerate. Not exactly with just 13%, you know, it's not going to have this huge amount of money going to paying people more. Big portion of it is going to those who are already wealthy. Mm-hmm. And so that's not really, you know, is that really going to have a big impact on the economy? Are those people who own the stocks and bonds and are already doing really well because we've had such massive moves up in asset prices, are they really going to spend that much more? You know, probably not a material impact from that point. So when looking at January, just talking about, you know, is this really panning out? We saw in January declines in industrial output, in real wages, in retail sales, and in the aggregate hours worked. So far, the story of an accelerating economy, I'm not seeing a ton of evidence that that's actually happening.
Yeah. And remember, this is one of the things that we talked about in January that was at least one of my concerns, which is expectations get ahead of themselves. And then we don't see the flow through from tax reform, the way people were expecting it to happen. It sounds like that might be playing out, but we'll of course keep watching it. So my theory on the next couple of weeks, it's a little more simplistic, I'm sorry to say, it's that the market's going to be essentially dancing around each data point as we get them, really until the Fed's March meeting. That's the 20th, 21st. And I say that because I think the psychology is investors in Wall Street are going to try and figure out what is the Fed going to do? What is the Fed going to say? So as if we get every data point, we're going to see the market move up or move down, depending on the quality and tone of that data. I also think people want to understand, you know, this is the first meeting with Powell, right? And while he's voted historically with Yellen, what's he really going to say now that he's the new Fed head in charge? Is he going to be as dovish or not? So I think people are looking to see that. Plus also too, at that meeting, we'll get their updated outlook on GDP and inflation. I think that the market's going to cue off of that pretty heavily. And my bet is that if it comes in GDP forecast a little better, the inflation number, according to the Fed, is a little hotter, we're going to have to reset some expectations once again. I'm not saying that's the catalyst for this, the big one that some people might be thinking is next, but it could certainly create a little more bumpiness in the path that we're about to go on. That's what I think. So what are you, between like this week, next week, Lenore, is there anything on the data front that's kind of catching your eye?
Well, actually, it's more on the policy front that I'm watching, because we've been talking about how with the fiscal spending, right, we increased spending plans for all this infrastructure, the tax cuts, that's kind of the idea, is that's hitting the accelerator pedal for the economy. And then on the other side, you're hitting the brakes with the Fed raising rates and tapering. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of, you know, driving with one foot on the brake and one foot on the
and gas, that's right? if you've ever driven with somebody like that, that is never a smooth or comfortable ride.
Never a good drive. Well, it's kind of interesting to see this week, we just got data that the U.S. import price index came in considerably higher than expected, at 3.6% versus an expectation for 3%. That was actually the largest increase since 2012. Now, that is primarily because the U.S. dollar has been so weak. Now, on the policy side, we're hearing all this talk that the administration wants to put tariffs on things like steel and aluminum. That's all about infrastructure, right?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
So if we actually do put these tariffs on, that just increases the raw material costs for so much of what is expected to be kind of a accelerator on the economy. So once again, there's another foot on the brake.
Yeah. And that comes at a time when people are trying to figure out how are state, local governments going to actually afford, raise the money to actually implement some of these programs that Trump is talking about. So yeah, it's right. that is a great call out.
He's talking about having it be kind of a mix of public and private, and there's all kinds of changes that could be made to the laws around that. We'll be watching for that. But I get really worried when I hear them say, you know, we really want to get the economy going, but we're going to increase the cost of some of the most base raw materials.
Exactly.
All right.
There's no other way to put it than that.
That's like, I love you, I hate you. I love you, I hate you.
Yeah, that's just, well, we'll see. We'll have to monitor that and see what happens, obviously. I mean, this could be Trump doing what we've seen as typical Trump, kind of like,
yeah, positioning. Exactly. It could be it'll be interesting to watch. What are you going to be looking out for?
Well, for this week, it's going to be the flash PMI reports from Market Economics for not China anymore, but Japan, the Eurozone, and the U.S. Taking a look at, you know, the obvious things we want to look at: orders, production, and backlog, to get a sense on the tone of the economy in February, but also input prices. Because again, you know, we saw, you know, the question that we're seeing more and more about is inflation. Is it there? Is it not? Is it there? Is it not? So just another data point to get a beat on whether it is or isn't there. So I'll be looking at that. And then next week, ooh, man, end of the month, start of the month, Lenore. I got to tell you, it is for you. You might be like a kid in the economic data candy store. For me, it's a lot of stuff. So the two that I'll be looking at is personal income and spending. And that gets back to what you were talking about earlier about the ability of the consumer to spend, because incomes have not been growing. We've been taking on more debt. Be looking at the savings rate, which, as you wrote about, hit, I think, 2.6% for the last month of data. It's the worst since, I think, 2005. And then in tandem with the speed of the economy and inflation data, I'll be taking a look at the ISM Manufacturing Index. So it's going to be interesting.
It'll also be interesting to see the election in Italy coming up on March 4th, how that comes out.
Somehow that didn't hit my calendar.
Yeah. Well, it'll be really interesting because you've got the way the Italian elections work, it's
isn't there some like crazy blackout period?
What?
I thought I read something about that.
You can't advertise some things, but what I find really interesting about the election coming up is, are we going to see continued rise of sort of this nationalism, this protectionism? Because you're getting some strange bedfellows here, different groups, different political parties that you think would not get along, but they're working together because they're so anti-immigration. Because Italy has a really tough time because it is the first nation right on the Mediterranean to get hit by these people fleeing, you know, some pretty rough places. Mm-hmm. So they get into Italy and then they try to move on to like France or Germany and they get stopped at the border and Italy's like, wait, I have to keep them? What happened? So, I mean, you've really seen in the past couple of years, travel around Europe has changed dramatically because it used to be, you know, everybody in the Schengen area, you didn't need passports to move from one country to another because it was just, you know, one region. That's not the case anymore. I mean, it's passport controls everywhere.
So when you travel, don't you whip out like three of them? Don't you have like three different passports?
The name is Bond.
I thought it was, where in the world is Lenore San Diego? That's who I thought you were. All right. So we'll obviously keep some tabs on that. That could prove a little more interesting.
Because it could get the markets a little bit nervous, right? If you start seeing
what?
If you start seeing more and more nationalism, and if you start seeing, because that nationalism means that the Eurozone gets a little weaker, right?
Right. So could this potentially jumpstart conversations about, along with Brexit, Italy Eve and all that other stuff that, oh, maybe this is once again back on.
Yeah, exactly. It just concerns that, I mean, that's kind of faded away, but this election could kind of bring that back up. Plus, depending on how the election goes, you could get some people in charge that are going to do a really poor job with an economy that is already struggling. And I mean, it's getting back on its feet, but.
I think there would be some people that would say, yeah, that's not the only country that's happened to.
Yeah, exactly.
All right. Let's pivot and do something we haven't done in a little while, which is some thematic signals. You know, it's been crazy the last couple of weeks here for the podcast, but I do like to talk about thematic signals because they're confirming data points for our investment themes. So, you know, with that, I'll go first. One of the ones that has, we've obviously been talking quite a bit about over the last year is our safety and security investing theme, which covers not just cybersecurity, but it takes a look at defense spending, homeland security spending, even local quote unquote security spending, which would be, you know, cops, firemen, that sort of thing. And what's interesting is we are seeing the government, as you've called out, Lenore, the government is back in spend mode. Right. They are opening up the purse strings. And now we're seeing a lot of defense companies try to pivot their businesses a little bit to capture the rebound in that spending. And what does that mean? Well, we're seeing a lot of M&A start to happen. So just to rattle off a couple and then we'll say what it means. ECS Federal was bought for $775 million by on assignment. Lockheed Martin did a spinoff several years ago, PAE. They're buying a firm, McFadden and Associates. But General Dynamics spending $6.8 billion to buy CRSA, one of the largest government IT service firms. And we've even seen some private equity shops get into the mix. Veritas Capital is acquiring the government business of PricewaterhouseCoopers and Arlington Capital Partners. They're buying a small engineering services firm to do the same. And so it's just fascinating that these companies, some of which had very little exposure to federal spending, are buying companies to get into that tailwind. Any thoughts? Yep.
Everybody's trying to dip their fingers into that little pot of gold that apparently those guys in DC have found one. I'm pretty sure what that means is they've gone over to the Treasury and said, hey, print away.
Well, I think we've expected some of this. I mean, Trump was talking about rebuilding the military, rebuilding security and stuff. So I think we're starting to see that happen. It's not surprising then to see some of these smaller firms kind of get taken out as the bigger ones look to pivot. And as we pointed out in the special report that we contributed to for the Washington Times that was dealing with cyber attacks, we were saying that, look, when it comes to our safety and security investing theme, we see a lot more M&A activity happening, whether it's defense contractors trying to buy our firms to get into the cybersecurity arena or position themselves for other aspects, the Internet of Things, for example. I just see this as confirmation of that push towards M&A, and I just think we're going to see more of it.
Absolutely.
Okay. Moving on.
Moving on. I think we've got another one. I read one that I think is sort of an intersection of the rise of the middle class that we've talked about in these emerging economies like India and China. And content is king. There was an interesting article in the Wall Street Journal talking about how China is becoming a major market for entertainment. And within the next 5 years, it's expected to become actually the world's biggest box office market. So with that, and China is notoriously difficult to get into, you have a lot of Hollywood companies that are getting the rights to release Chinese films here in the US. Now, they don't really expect to make much. If they break like a million, they're pretty happy.
Right.
But what they're doing is starting to get those relationships so that the Hollywood studios can have the relationships and they can get that access into what will be. Because right now we're the number one box office, but that's not going to be the case anymore. And with that, I think you're going to see kind of a change. You know, everything was very American centric, right? It was American culture dominated the world. Well, that's not going to be the case anymore when you have China and eventually we'll have India as well, where they are more and more of a content consumer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so no, I totally. I mean, there was a couple of years ago, I think if you were to look at some of the financing for some of the Tom Cruise movies or even Sylvester Stallone with The Expendables, it did okay here, but it killed in the overseas box office, particularly over in Asia. And I think you're right. I just see that coming together. It'll be interesting to watch, too, some of the financings for the films that we're seeing, because I remember sometime in the last, I don't know, I want to say 3 to 6 months, that when the credits came on, it was like Alibaba's film arm was helping finance some of the movies. It was just fascinating to see.
And I think it's also going to affect where they're produced, the competition for where these things get produced.
Are you saying Marvel might leave and go leave Georgia and go to another Georgia?
Could be.
Okay. All right. All right. Now, you were also saying, too, that something going on in Europe and the cashless consumption.
Yes. Yeah. So with our cashless consumption theme, I was reading that every year since the Great Recession, the use of actual physical cash, like coins or cash, in Sweden has been declining. And there's actually a lot of establishments don't even accept cash. Now, when I read that, I thought, well, that's kind of interesting. That is one really great way to prevent tax fraud.
Isn't that, that's just what you see over in Italy, right?
Yeah, exactly. So when I was reading this, I was thinking, yeah, I don't see that happening here anytime soon. Because there really is. When you go, if you have a restaurant, say, that you frequent regularly and you get to know the proprietors, there is the price if you pay with a credit card, and then right. There is the price if you're a friend and you pay with cash. And guaranteed, those don't all get reported.
You know, and somebody was asking me if I thought the mafia was dead over the weekend. Strange.
Oh, really?
I'm just saying, you know, with that example you just provided, it's like somebody knows somebody.
Yeah, go down to Southern Italy. No, it's still there. Well, you were talking about something out of the Winter Olympics.
I will, and I'll get to that in a second, but I first have to ask, we haven't really talked much about the Winter Olympics at all. And I'm just wondering, do you have a favorite event? Silence.
Snowboard, the half pipe.
I like that too, until I heard some very bad things about the Red Tomato in his past, that he was hashtag me too kind of a guy.
Yeah, I don't know.
I know. I'm just saying. So, you know, it's usually I tend to watch, I like the ice hockey, you know, as well as a couple other events. And I feel really bad for Lindsey Vonn.
Yeah. Just what happened. Oh, my God. And did you see the crap that she was getting on Twitter? Oh, my God. I mean, come on. This is a woman, because she's apparently not a huge fan of the president. So people were jumping all over her on Twitter for, I mean, she lost, like, I think she was something like 3/100ths of a second or some number was the difference between her being in, I think, sixth and the first place. And I mean, really?
As somebody who swam, and I'm not saying this happened to me. No, not saying that at all. That touch out can really kill you. It can really kill you. But you are right. I mean, it's fascinating to think about the technology involved to measure down to such levels that you can actually see that.
Oh my God.
Isn't that crazy? That's crazy. Yeah. Well, anyway, speaking of technology and the Winter Olympics, see that? I took one out of your playbook. Yeah. I got a transition there. One of the interesting technologies that we're seeing demoed at the 2018 Winter Olympics is 5G. And we're seeing it from companies like Intel and South Korean mobile carrier KT. So yes, 5G networks are still being developed. We still have a lot to go. The networks have to be built. We have to get devices, that sort of thing. We have to get the RF semiconductors done. But at the Olympics, Intel is using all that firepower, which is 5G is about 10 times faster than 4G, if you can believe it. So they're doing 4K and in some instances, 8K video.
Wow.
That's just, I mean, I can't even imagine what that looks like. But Intel isn't the only one. Hyundai, South Korea's one of their auto manufacturers there, is letting people test out their autonomous driving car dubbed the Nexo SUV. It's got an infotainment system that uses KT's 5G technology, and it lets users control the smart home devices, locks, lightings from the road. So kind of cool. But this is the part I think that you, Lenore, would really appreciate the most. It's an in-car infotainment system that you can stream songs into karaoke to.
Oh, I am in.
I'm picturing you 1980s rock. That's what I'm thinking.
Oh, hell yeah. Hell yeah. Big hair bands. I'm all over that.
And then the other one that's kind of notable on the 5G front at the Olympics is Samsung, where they're really using it to power some pretty cool concepts in virtual reality. They've got a simulated, for you, Lenore, snowboarding and cross-country skiing competition for fans, as well as a virtual reality space mission. Not really sure what that's about, but the idea is that it lets people experience lunar gravity. I'm not really sure how that
cool.
Oh, it would be cool.
So cool.
I don't know how you do that standing there. It's kind of like, you know, I just can't picture it.
I'm in.
Well, anyway, a lot of this, again, is powered by 5G. We've got AT&T, Verizon, T-Mobile, all bringing commercial networks to the U.S. in 2019. It's something that we've been watching very closely on the select list at Tematica Investing. We've got some investments lined up there, and we expect to hear a lot more about 5G at the Mobile World Congress, and that runs from February 26th through March 1st. So hang on to your hats. We're going to hear a lot more about that.
Well, I had one last one, which is just sort of a fun one, kind of in our line of the fattening of the population, that things just aren't quite so tasty over at Yum Brands. Because Kentucky Fried
Chicken. Stop. How long have you been trying to put that together?
No, I was pretty proud of myself when I came up with that. KFC had to close, get this, this is just awesome. KFC had to close around 800 of their 900 locations in the UK this week because they get this, they ran out of chicken. I mean, seriously, you had one job, KFC. You had one job. You ran out of chicken. So, and Britain, it's even worse because Britain is KFC's largest market in Europe and it's one of its top five globally. So now apparently the shortage of the chickens was caused by what they called teething problems, you got to love that, with their new delivery partner, DHL. They had switched away from a company called Bidvest Logistics last Wednesday. And apparently the transition had been a bit bumpy, to say the least.
So is that, so you see that, I mean, it's funny, obviously, but it doesn't sound like it's a full-blown problem, more of like a temporary disruption, right?
A temporary disruption, yeah. But you had one job.
Well, no. The reason I ask is
I want my damn chicken. Can you imagine? You go, you want finger licking.
You and Steve Harvey. I understand.
You get pup kiss. I would be so mad.
Well, here is my thing though. If this was not a disruption, if it was actually a supply shortage, then all of a sudden that means like good pricing for companies like Tyson Foods, for example, or Pilgrim's Pride. But it doesn't sound like
this. It's more like DHL going, oops. They could probably not so good from them. I wonder if UPS is in the wings going, hello.
Hello, my friend. How are you?
Hello, Galeries.
Well, was that, what was that? That Lionel Richie song? Hello.
Is it me?
Me you're looking for.
On that note.
The only thing I'll say about that before we get out of here is we should definitely never karaoke.
Oh no, I think there's actually an inverse relationship between one's need to karaoke and one's skill at doing so.
More on that on the next episode of Cocktail Investing. Have fun, everybody. We'll see you next week.
Have a great week.